Hello friends and everyone, welcome back to our discussion on economic survey. Today we are going to discuss chapter 8, that is innovation trending up in India. The chapter itself mentions that the thrust for innovation has been rising, innovation trending up in India, but needs thrust especially from private sector. This is the chapter 8 which exclusively talked about innovation trends in India based on evidence and the time period, the trends in a particular time period. Again, like I mentioned in the very first chapter, this chapter also, the four approach, the timing, evidence based policy making, empirical data, this approach is clearly visible in this discussion on this chapter as well. So this chapter we are going to see the trends in innovation based on the backdrop of recent India's performance on the Global Innovation Index. In the recently released Global Innovation Index 2022, India ranked for the first time below 50. India ranked 48 out of 131 countries. So it was a very good performance compared to India's earlier rankings, compared to India's earlier rankings. In the backdrop of this, we are going to have discussion on innovation trends. As all of you know, the innovation index, Global Innovation Index, released by three organizations, Cornell University, INSEAD and World Intellectual Property Organization. These three organizations combinedly release Global Innovation Index every year, and the index has been started since 2007. They release this index onwards. They release this index every year. They from 2007 onwards they have been releasing this index every year. So this year India ranked 48, and the rank is the performance of India is a huge improvement. If you compare the time period between 2015 to 2020, in 5 years, India improved almost half of its ranking. In 2015, the rank was 81 and today it is 48. Today it is 48 out of 31 countries. Before we going to have a discussion on innovation trends in India and India's performance on Global Innovation Index, now let's have some discussion on what GIE, what are the major parameters, what are the major pillars, what are the major sub pillar, and what are the indicators that we take into account while calculating Global Innovation Index. See, the generally Global Innovation Index has two sub indices, 7 pillars, 20 sub pillars, and 82 indicators. 82 indicators are 82 parameters. In some of the parameters, India has exceptionally performed well. India performed exceptionally well. For example, India ranked first in service exports out of 131 countries. If you consider the parameter service exports, India has been ranked number one. So out of these two sub indices, we have 5 pillars related to innovation input sub indices, innovation input sub index, innovation output sub index. So innovation input sub index has 5 pillars, innovation index innovation output sub index has 2 pillars. So innovation input sub index, the 5 pillars, if you see the India's position in 5 pillars, India's position in institutions pillar 61 rank, India's position in human capital and research, India's performance again not up to the mark, 60th. When it comes to the infrastructure, India's rank has been very poor. It is 75th rank. And market sophistication and business sophistication, India's performance is relatively good. India's rank, the ranks in these two sub pillars are 31st and 55th in respectively. So market sophistication, India's rank is 31. Business sophistication, India's rank is 55. When it comes to India innovation output sub index, index as two pillars. Again, I mentioned earlier, knowledge and technological output, India's rank is 27. So this is a good perform, it's a good rank compared to the other pillars. On the pillar, sub pillar, knowledge and technological output, India's rank is 27. But when it comes to creative outputs, India's rank is again not up to the mark. It is India rank 64th. India rank is 64th. But in some of the sub pillars, like I told, knowledge and technological output in a pillar, India's rank is 27, and creative outputs India's pillar, creative outputs pillar, India rank is 64th. But all these 7 pillars again divided into 20 sub pillars. All the 7 pillars again divided into 20 sub pillars, and India's performance is relatively good in some of the sub pillar. If you take the example, for example, if you take sub pillar, India's rank is 10th in knowledge output. Knowledge output sub pillar, India's rank is 10th. Creative knowledge output, India's rank is 10th. And trade and commerce, if you consider India's rank in trade and commerce, India's rank is 15th. So though its rank is not up to the mark in sub pillars, in some pillars, in if you consider some sub pillars, India's rank is relatively good. And these sub pillars again divided into 82 parameters or 82 indicators. India's rank has been exceptionally good in some of the indicators, like service exports, India ranked first. Third in domestic market scaling, India's rank is third in domestic market scaling, and ninth in government's online servicing, online service provision. So most of the governments providing online services, for example, if you take Andhra Pradesh, online services through eSeva or MeSeva, there is a dedicated online platform for providing on the government services through online. So that's why India ranked 9th in when it comes to the indicator online service provision to the citizens. So this is about the some of the constituents of the Global Innovation Index. So India's rank has been improved from 81 in 2015 to 48 in 2020. Now let's come to the discussion on what innovation, what are the trends of innovation, why does innovation matters for any country? Why do any country needs innovation? That's what we are going to discuss now. Now, this why innovation matters for any country, you know, if you discuss about various models, solo model, new growth model, and sumpterian model, all this model based on the empirical data and based on the evidence, they try to explain the need of innovation. You know, in this present industrialization era, mostly after industrial revolution, most of the growth in majority of developed countries happened just because innovation. Innovation brings about changes in the economic production, it brings about changes in the output of the worker. The output of the worker increases mainly because if there is a technological growth, if there is a technological creativity, if there is a technological innovation. So innovation has directly and indirectly leads to the growth of country in all manner. Let's take the example of solo model. Solo model explains the output per worker mainly depends on savings, population growth of a country, and also the technological progress achieved by the country. So the technological progress is sine qua non for development of any country. So it is a prerequisite for long-term economic growth. For long-term economic growth, technological progress is prerequisite for growth of any country. That's what explained by the solo model. So the solo model is a exogenous model. Like the development or technological progress or growth of a country should happen from the outside influence. But where if you take this solo model further explained by the Burrow and Mankin, they explained this model, they extended and explained this model with lot of empirical data. When this solo model is exogenous model, the new growth model endogenous is the development, endogenous is the technological progress, endogenous is the long-term economic growth. So growth, all this growth model talks about the need of innovation. So this new growth model says that if you have proper developed human capital, proper robust infrastructure, and also there is a flow of new ideas in a country, and also improving quality of the existing product, need for improving quality of the existing products. One is human capital, second is infrastructure, third is flow of new ideas in the country, and also the need for improving the quality of existing product. All these two, four indicators will explains the need of innovation. These indicators explains the need of innovation and the long-term economic growth happens in a country. And this further explained by the Sumpterian model. Sumpterian model is about disruptive technology, disruptive technological progress. When there is a disruptive technology happens in any country, the old technology gets disrupted or gets replaced by the new technology, new developments, new product development, new service development. So the need of disruptive technology explained by the Sumpterian model also explains why innovation matters for any country. So innovation in and all, if you take any model, innovation does matter to any country for its growth, welfare of the people, and growth in the long run. So to achieve this growth, technological progress and innovation are prerequisite. Let's take the key highlights of the current situation in India. What is this key highlights of India's position in the global innovation index? Based on the India's performance of global innovation index, let's take the trends in and the key highlights of the current trends and current structure of innovation in India. If you see this key highlights based on the evidence, the India to become a leader, because already India is the fifth largest economy and is the third largest economy in terms of PPP and second most populous country. We have whose opportunity of demographic dividend. So India to become the innovation leader, and we need a greater thrust on innovation and R&D. Now if you see the key highlights, India's gross domestic expenditure on R&D has been very minimal. It is only one of the lowest when compared to the our neighbors also, or our peers in the BRICS group, or if you compare the any of the developing countries. So it has been very minimal. And also whatever gross expenditure we are spending on innovation and R&D, that majority of that comes from government. So India's government expenditure on GRD, or gross expenditure on research and development through government in India, is three times more than most of the developed countries. So India's government spending on research and development is more than three times if you take any of the developed countries, because in developed countries, majority of the R&D needs are taken care by the market and private and business players. That's what the chapter itself talks about. So similarly, the number of research personnel in India is also very lowest. The research personnel and the researchers and the research institutions also very less in India. Another key highlight of this survey, or another key highlight, are the findings in Global Innovation Index is the number of patents and trademarks filed in India by the Indian residents. Understand the term, understand the keywords. The number of patents, number of the trademarks filed in India by the Indian residents has been very low compared to any of the developed countries. For example, you take China itself, which is our very neighbor. If you take the number of patents registered by the Indian residents in India is very low. This is a major concern on innovation or India's performance on trademarks and patents. So India resident share in total patents filed is only 36%, but it is 62% in other countries. Majority of the developed countries, it is more than 62% is the number of patents and trademarks filed by the native residents, but in India only 36% of Indian patents filed in India. If you consider total number of patents, only 36 patents are filed in India, and it is by the only Indian residents. It is a major concern, because most of the patents in India are registered by the non-resident Indians. So this is definitely there needs to be a comprehensive reforms and reinvigoration of research position, reinvigoration of innovation needs in India. Let's also view whether India is a positive outlier in the current performance. Is India a positive outlier, or India's performance is up to the mark in the GIA latest Global Innovation Index, keeping in view of its developmental needs, growing GDP, growing size of GDP, growing population, or growing per capita income. If you consider this data, is India a positive outlier? Yes, it is a positive outlier if you consider the development trend. If you consider keeping in view of its population and per capita income, the growth of innovation or the performance of India in the Global Innovation Index is a positive layer only if you consider the population and per capita income. But if you consider the size of GDP and the GDP trends, India is a negative outlier. If you consider the because India has emerged as $2.9 trillion economy, and it is supposed to become $5 trillion economy by 24 and 25. If you consider this GDP size and growth patterns, India is definitely negative outlier. It means that India's performance is not up to the mark and below par, below average performance. When you compare this GIA performance with reference to the GDP size and GDP growth. Now also see these, do you think because of only its population, India's performance is positive, India's is a positive outlier, but when it comes to GDP, it is negative, there is a divergence among its population and GDP growth. Now let's see this other question, India's innovation performance compared to the top 10 countries. Yes, so India's performance, top 10 countries in on its based on the GDP data. So India's is currently the, like I told earlier, India is currently the fifth largest economy and third largest economy in terms of PPP, and it posed to become the largest economy by 2040s. It posed to become the largest economy if you utilize it, is the if you achieve our potential GDP, India is also supposed to become the largest economy by 2040s. Like, although India has performed exceptionally, performed above expectation or innovation with respect to its level of development, but it lags behind if you compare India's performance with some of the top 10 countries like USA, China. Its performance is poor. For example, India's R&D expenditure, or India's research personnel, or India's researchers, research number of researchers in India, or India's number of patents filed in India, if you compare its performance with any other top 10 countries, India is second lowest in all countries, only after Brazil. Brazil is the lowest country. After Brazil is second, India is the second lowest country. It is 9th rank in all performance. It is almost at the bottom on all these indicators just I talked about, the when it comes to the GERD or number of patents or number of personnel in R&D or the number of R&D. If you consider all these performance, all these indicators, India's performance is lowest. India's performance is better only than Brazil. when it comes to when you compare all other developed countries, India performance is very low, very low. It's lowest. So how let's take how China has been, if you has been one of the top performing on global innovation index. How let's compare India's position and China's position, because China is our immediate neighbor, and what are the reforms that worked in favor of China on innovation index? Let's take the example, India's rank in 2015 was 181 and now it is 48. In the same time period, China rank has been improved from 29 in 2015 to 14. 14 in 2020. So is this a huge improvement on China's performance? What worked in favor of China? So China has R&D roadmap. There is a long-term plan for inculcating R&D ecosystem in China. What it has done? It has a 15-year medium and long-term plan. MLP of China. It is a 15-year medium and long-term plan for promoting research and development ecosystem in India, ecosystem in China, that worked in favor of China, which ultimately China improved its rank from 29 in 2015 to 14 in 2020. So how did this plan work? Because China spent almost 2.5% of gross domestic expenditure on R&D allocated. China allocated 2% of its GDP as its GERD, and it also inculcated the spirit of innovation oriented society among its education curriculum. Innovation, spirit of innovation oriented society, and also it calls for indigenous innovation. That's why China emerged as one of the master player in electronics and semiconductor industry, that especially for when it comes to semiconductor industry and mobile phone industry, it is one of the major player, because through R&D it tries to promote indigenous, locally developed, indigenous innovation, domestic development of innovation, that worked in favor of China. So that performance of China has been very exceptionally good compared to India. Now let's compare the R&D expenditure in India. R&D expenditure, like I said earlier, a little earlier, the India's total GERD, the global gross domestic expenditure on R&D is 0.7% of the GDP, which is the lowest if you compare the top 10 economies. So 0.7%, even of the minimal amount, majority of this comes from the government, 56% from the government, and only 37% of GERD comes from the private. So this, that is why the outset of the discussion, at the outset of this chapter, this mentioned that especially from private sector we need major thrust. So that is why there is a reverse in the trend of innovation expenditure, R&D expenditure, right now we are spending in India. Similarly, if you compare the top 10 economies, the GERD is only, this should be increased from the present 37% to 68% to move on par with the other top 10 countries. Similarly, if you take the India's performance of patent market has been growing since 1999. Since 1999, we have been legislated number of acts to promote patent market in India, to promote patent registration in India, to promote trademarks in India. Like, we have brought reforms in Patent Act 1970, Trademarks Act 99 has been enacted. Since 1999, the number of patents and trademarks that have been registered in India have been growing. Like I said earlier, unlike India, Brazil, Canada and other top 10 countries have a higher share of patents by their residents, but in India,
higher share of residents, higher share of registrations are not through Indians but non-residents. Non-residents. So Indian performance, Indian residents are accounting for only 36% of patent registrations. Similarly, 62% is the average in other countries, and the 62% in our resident patents are through residents, the native residents in other countries. In India, only 36. Even Brazil, which lags behind, India compared to most of the indicators. Like I said, is India comparison of the top 10 countries with India's performance in GI, Brazil lags in most of the indicators, lags behind India. But when it comes to India, patent registration, even Brazil is also outlier, is a outperformer compared to India. There also, Brazil also, majority of the patents and trademarks registered by their residents. Similarly, if you compare the trademarks, India's trademarks has been also rising, but the trademarks trend, most of the trademarks are registered by the Indian residents compared to the patent registration. This is because there is a positive sign because of the advancement of innovation through market. Trademarks, because of market intervention, most of the market development, India's growth, in the last two decades, India growth interlinked with the market expansion, market development, and also it was also driven by the improvement in the demand or boosting the demand. That is why most of the trademarks are by the Indian residents. But anyway, if you compare international standards, the trademarks position is better compared to patent registration in India. But if you compare international standards, it is also lags behind on some of the top 10 biggest countries on GDPS criteria, if you take GDPS criteria. So is India innovation affected by access to finance, also questioned by the survey. That question is also discussed thoroughly. Is India's innovation performance affected by equity finance? No, India's, if you availability of the equity and debt finance, India's performance is again negative outlier. If you compare most of the developed countries or top 10 countries on GDP, the capital availability, the equity availability and the debt market availability is very liberal in India. Still, the performance is, innovation performance lags behind compared to the top 10 countries where there are strict laws for equity finance and debt finance. So just because the cooperation from private and business activity in innovation promotion is very less, that is why India is a negative outlier in when you question the question, when you take the innovation affected by the availability of the finance, access to finance. So now, what should be the policy implication to improve the present situation? There are certain advantages for India. So India is highly attractive for R&D destination. If you consider the data, empirical data from the existing sources, so it is a high potential destination for R&D improvement. R&D, we have opportunities in the form of good and robust infrastructure for outsourcing, highly skilled labor force. We also have low cost labor and low cost R&D activities. That is why most of the countries set up R&D labs in India. So like if you take R&D labs of IBM, R&D labs of Google, R&D labs of Microsoft have been set up to make use of these advantages. So particularly India to become the India has this world class potential both in R&D center and target R&D development, and we can also target global markets. So to achieve this, what should be the policy implications? Let's see what should be the policy implication in the near future so that India will become the major player in R&D and research. So to do that, government should gradually increase the present gross expenditure on R&D from present 0.7% of GDP to 2% of GDP, and from there it slowly it can increase this GERD from 2.5%, 3% on par with the top 10 countries in the coming future. So this is the most striking prerequisite for changing the R&D ecosystem in India. And even in that R&D, GERD, the most of the and majority of the GERD should come from the private sector or business activity. If you take the present data, currently right now private sector contributing only 37% of GERD. So to make use of India's huge potential for R&D and innovation R&D and innovation promotion, this GERD from private sector should be increased from present 37% to 68%. 68%. If you also consider the other parameters like number of R&D personnel and researchers, researchers in the business sector, number of R&D personnel and researchers in the business sector or private sector is 30% and 34% respectively. Number of R&D personnel is 30% from the private sector and 34% is researchers from the private sector. Rest are in the government sector. What we do to what now we should do to promote R&D from the business activity or in the corporate sector or in the private sector? We need to improve gradually to global average. Global average is 50%, more than 50%. 53 and 54% respectively when it comes to research personnel and researchers, R&D personnel and number of researchers. So we also need to gradually improve the number of persons in the private sector to 50% of the contribution, The other is the patents registered by the Indian residents should also be increased gradually. So like we have IPR policy 2016, we already enacted IPR policy 2016. That policy should be utilized to create awareness. So to also promote innovation, we also bring about majority of the reforms in the education. Illiteracy, we need to improve the literacy rate. Also, apart from improving the literacy rate, we also bring about reforms in school education. Already India introduced new education policy, which is it's a good direction and it is a progressive direction to improve the innovation and R&D ecosystem in India. Similarly, given the low level of contribution from GERD by the business sector, despite generous incentives, so even though government offering more incentives for promoting R&D in the business sector, its performance is low, but recently India, as part of Atmanirbhar package and as part of budget introduced PLI scheme, project linked incentive scheme, definitely it will give boost to promote innovation and R&D in India. So if you follow this policy implication on the lines of China's medium and long term policy for promoting R&D, medium and long term plans, MLT plans for promoting R&D, and simultaneously increasing India's expenditure on R&D, we will be in the direction of utilizing whose demographic dividend by way of promoting R&D and innovation. If you consider all the earlier economic surveys like 2020, 2019 and 20, which exclusively mentions about the entrepreneurship and wealth creation at the grassroots, in this chapter it did discuss about the startup ecosystem and the need for promotion of startup ecosystem, which has high advantages of high advantage in the form of boosting demand growth and leading to the long term economic growth. So to make use of startup ecosystem and wealth creation at the grassroots level, we need to promote innovation and R&D. So to utilize this innovation and R&D, we should also bring about reforms from the ground level. So apart from making these reforms, the inculcation of spirit of scientific temper as envisaged in 51A of the Constitution of India, 51A of the Constitution of India talks about promoting scientific temper and inculcating the spirit of science among Indian citizens. If you take that spirit, if you improve that spirit from the ground level, from the grassroots level, definitely India is in the direction of achieving innovation and R&D ecosystem, and also it is in the direction of emerging major leader in the innovation and R&D sector. Thank you very much.